It's easy to take birds for granted, but one in four have disappeared since 1970. Wildlife biologist Danielle Belleny champions their value in our ecology, along with the fun in getting to know and nurture them. She's also co-founder of Black Birders Week in response to police brutality and killings of Black people, racism in nature activities, and to encourage inclusive engagement outdoors. Danielle, welcome.
It's nice to be here.
First, why are birds so important, and why did you get involved?
So birds are important just because they exist. I think we definitely need to take a step back and stop assigning a human value to things that are sharing the same world with us. They're important just because they're here. But they also do have a range of benefits, ecologically, and also monitoring pests. Birds are absolutely inspirational. I'm sure you've seen a bird and it just makes you want to, just smile. And that's good enough for me.
Why are we seeing fewer birds?
There's definitely a couple things. It's not just one thing that points to the decline of birds. And mainly we see these declines in birds in these very critical habitats like grasslands or tundras, and also in forests. These are areas that are, being changed due to land use change, urbanization, but especially climate change. Those things are impacting our bird populations.
So then how did Black Birders Week get started?
Yeah, so like you mentioned in your intro, Black Birders Week was definitely a response to police brutality and also really unfortunate confrontations and racism that Black people experience while recreating outdoors. And we wanted to address the fact that these disparities happen to us and we want them to stop, but also to amplify the fact that we enjoy these spaces and there's so much Black joy in outdoor recreation and nature and in gardening and all kinds of things.
What challenges have you faced as a Black wildlife biologist?
Yeah, I've definitely been hesitant to stop somewhere to want to bird, maybe because I'm unfamiliar or maybe because there's either a signia or something that makes me not want to stop in those locations. But also I've been followed when I am bird watching. People look at me and I guess assume I'm a suspicious person for trying to look at birds. And it's really discouraging, but I'm not going to stop doing what I love.
I'm sorry that you or anybody would have to face that kind of concern or that fear when what you're trying to do is make this a better world. When are we going to see Black Birders Week 2021 and how do we get involved?
Yeah, Black Birders Week 2020 was a great success. So we're definitely going to put on Black Birders Week 2021. You can expect to see us May 30th through June 5th. And you can follow us on Instagram and Twitter. We're in the works of a website that'll also point folks towards all the things that you need to get to. But follow us, and I refer to us, the people that started Black Birders Week, at Black AF in STEM, S-T-E-M. And you will be able to see past events from Black Birders Week 20, and then also see what we have going on and plans for 21. But you can also follow hashtag Black in Nature. That is another great hashtag that'll lead you probably to us, but also a bunch of other Black nature enthusiasts.
But coming up sooner than that is Audubon's Great Backyard Bird Count, February 12th through the 15th. So what's that all about and why should we get involved?
Yeah, so the Great Backyard Bird Count is this worldwide initiative, and it's encouraging folks to at least spend 15 minutes outside counting as many birds as they can. And it's just a really fun, like, collaborative science project that you get to do with your whole community. And you get to see these results of what birds are in your area in real time. This data also helps scientists figure out what type of global trends these birds are doing, but also conservation practices that we can implement to better save these birds. Like we mentioned, they are declining.
So what if you don't have a backyard or any kind of yard? Where do you recommend going?
Yeah, you can go really anywhere that is outside, whether that's looking through your window or on your back patio. My personal favorite place to go bird watching lately is cemeteries, which I know it does sound a little weird, but it's basically a park. Our nation's park systems were inspired by cemeteries, actually. So it's a nice place to reconnect with nature while also paying respects to our ancestors at the same time.
I love that. What a great idea. A lot of us know, you know, the basic, you know, the birds that we see the most often. But there are a lot of birds I couldn't identify, and especially when it comes to some, there's so many different kinds of sparrows and wrens and woodpeckers. And so how can we figure out what we've seen?
Yeah, definitely don't be discouraged if you don't know what it is that you're looking at. There's an app for that. And you can use a Merlin Bird ID app. If you come across a bird that you're unfamiliar with, you can actually follow the prompts on screen and they'll show you the possibilities of what you saw after you enter, like the size, the colors that you saw, and the location that you saw the bird in. They'll give you some options. But also, if you don't get it right, I mean, that's part of birding. People get IDs wrong all the time. So again, don't feel bad if you don't know what you're looking at.
That's excellent advice, because it's the same thing in gardening. And and if you go out in parks and nature trails and you're not quite sure about the native plants, it's okay. You know, there are apps to figure that out. And if you make a mistake, someone will know the answer. And that's a good way to get connected with your world, you know, really stopping and to notice, to try and, okay, exactly what were the colors and what were the bandings, or in this flower, how many petals did it have? And it really makes you more thoughtful and introspective, and you start paying attention. And as you know, as a wildlife biologist, once we start paying attention, then we start getting connected, and then we start nurturing, and then we start caring and protecting.
That's the most important part, the excitement that stems all those blocks to fall in place.
Yes. Now, something I've thought about for years is getting a pair of binoculars. It's on the list, and I've looked at many of, you know, I've looked at them here and there over the years. I have some older ones. They're really heavy. They're kind of heavy to use. For someone maybe who wants to kind of dabble into this or kind of get started, but they don't want to make a huge investment and they're not even sure how to go about this, what is it that you recommend, the basic things to look for in a first pair of binoculars?
Sure. I'll preface by saying you definitely don't need binoculars to be a birder. You can do all this stuff without them. But if you do take that leap to want to start with binoculars, it definitely takes some learning. I personally am still learning my binoculars that I've had for some years, and I feel like I learn every new things every time I go out with them. There are price ranges. On the lower end of price range are like Bushnell binoculars. That's the pair of binoculars that I started birding with. I really loved them for the years that I used them. So you can get binoculars around $25 with them. And then Nikon also has binoculars that are less than $100. And so does Nox, N-O-C-S. It's a brand that's fairly new. They're really brightly colored and have some really cute straps. I think they're also compact, which are make them very easy to carry and portable. Theirs are also less than $100. So if you are looking to invest that money into binoculars, I think that's a good place to start with. You'll notice there's two numbers on your binoculars. There's separated by this X. So the first number could be an 8 or a 10 or something like that. That is the magnification. That means, you know, how much closer that image is going to appear when you're looking through binoculars. And then the second number is talking about how much light is being entered into your binoculars, which that second number is a little confusing, I understand, but you want a bigger number that will allow you to get more light and allow the picture that you're seeing to be more bright and more colorful.
As gardeners, what can we do to encourage the birds to be in our yards year round?
So Audubon actually has this really great website for plants for birds. And if you just type that into Google, Audubon plants for birds, it'll take you to their website. You enter your zip code and it'll tell you exactly what plants throughout the year are good for birds and butterflies and pollinators and all kinds of things in your yard. And it will also lead you to places locally that you can buy those plants from. So it's a really great and dynamic website to help gardeners or anyone who wants to get more native plants, especially in their yards. They need winter cover, they need summer cover, they need food throughout those times. They also need water too. So think about those types of resources that you can put into your yard.
So then on supplemental feeding, how do you feel about that?
Oh yeah, I'm pro supplemental feeding. I especially think it's important, you know, as the habitats that birds used to have are being removed by land use change, by urbanization. I think it is important to provide them some resources so they can have the fuel to find their natural food sources at the same time. Definitely clean your feeders though. That is an important step to prevent bird diseases from spreading from bird to bird. And yeah, just keep them healthy.
That's great advice. Thank you. Grackles get pooped on a lot. So why should we love the grackles?
I mean, again, they remind me so much of home. Just hearing them reminds me of just home and being together. And that alone lets me defend grackles. But also their iridescence, the shininess of their feathers. Like if you just take a closer look at them, and maybe if you see them outside of the context of a parking lot, you can actually see their beauty a little bit more. But I think they're great birds.
The past few weeks, we've heard so much about the cedar waxwings. They've really come through this year. And then the robins. I've been hearing about that, though. I haven't seen the robins, but I haven't seen the goldfinches. Basically, what are some of the factors that impact migration numbers?
Yeah, so when we see these finches and robins, waxwings, also nuthatches, coming further south than they typically do, and also in these large flocks, usually it's because of an eruption year, eruption with an I, and that's because their food resources up north are less plentiful, so they need to come further south, the birds need to come further south to get their food. And this happens often, it happens like every 4 years sometimes, and it's a natural occurrence. This is just the ebbs and flows of their food sources and the relationships that the birds have with them. So you'll get a really awesome chance to see more migrants than you typically do in southern areas.
Well, tell us again, how can people follow you and Black AF in STEM online?
Yeah, so Black AF in STEM is where Black Birders Week information and more information about how you can help be an ally, but also how you can be part of the team for Black Birders Week and beyond. And you can also find me at Bells Is Birding. That's B-E-L-L-Z-I-S Birding on Instagram and on Twitter. You'll see a lot of bird pictures and a lot of cemetery birding talk there.
Wonderful. It is so great to meet you. And maybe we'll see you out in the field.
I hope so.
And we'll say, what's that bird, Danielle?